Well, I think today you could say we're going to take it to the extreme. Well, we're after what are called extreme values, which are, you can think of them as the largest possible or smallest possible. We make it sound fancy. We use the phrases maximums and minimums. This is a really good motivation for calculus, is trying to understand, how do we find maximums and minimums? How do we make sure that we know something is a maximum or a minimum? And how do we go about really in general understanding functions? So, well, it's important. So let's begin. We're going to start by taking some time to really define what we mean by maximums and minimums. And there's sort of two flavors. We can talk about something called an absolute, sometimes called global, minimum and maximum. And what does that mean? Well, suppose I want to say I am the absolute maximum of the function. When we talk about those, we're talking about the outputs of the function. So we say, if at some value for x, c, so c is a location, then the value of the function at c is always greater than or equal to the value of the function anywhere else. Then we say, look, this is the largest possible value the function can attain. No other input takes a larger value. So that's what we mean by the maximum. Nothing gets larger than that. Similar idea. You're an absolute minimum if at your point C, no matter what else you plug in, you can never go below what the value is at C. So C is the lowest output your function can produce. So those are the absolute ones. Now, there's a second variety, which are the local variety. So what's the difference? Well, the difference is, where do we look? Because you'll see in the absolute, we said, look, I don't care what value for x. You could plug in a value x like way, way over there and compare. But when we talk about local, we're saying nearby, nearby. Now, of course, whenever you use a phrase like near, there's a question, what does the word near actually mean? And the answer is, well, it means what we need it to mean. So it all depends on context. So some functions, near could be, well, within one. Maybe some functions, you're within a millionth. It could be even smaller. It really just means that near C, in some, what we like to say, open neighborhood. So if you go at C and you perturb in either direction, assuming you can perturb in either direction, all points near C in either direction, then you say, look, there's either nothing larger than it for the output, that's a local max, or there's nothing smaller in the output, and that's a local min. Now, there's a really good question to ask, because when you first hear things like max and min, you say, okay, it's bigger than everything else, or it's smaller than everything else. But if you look at the way we did our definitions, you might notice something here. In particular, you see that you have a greater than or equal to, or a less than or equal to going on, right? So the question is, why do we allow equality? Why don't we just say strictly greater or strictly smaller? So let's answer that question, because it is a good question to ask, and there is a reason that we do it. And so we have to understand why we chose the way that we chose. And here's sort of the philosophy. One of the reasons why we want to talk about things like global maximum and global minimum is, let's take a function that we're familiar with, the sine function. Now, the sine function, we're kind of seeing it a lot, actually. It looks something like this. It's periodic. Now, let me ask you the question. What is the global maximum? Well, the global maximum of the sine function is 1, because the output of the sine always is bounded. It's bounded between negative 1 and positive 1. Now, where does it attain it? Well, it attains it infinitely often. You know, every step of 2 pi along the way here, it's going to get a value of 1. So, because it's going to attain at multiple points, we can't have a strict inequality, because I have to compare it to everywhere. So in other words, the output here at 1 has to become comparable to the output here of 1 later on. So if I had a strict inequality, we would say that the sine function doesn't have a global maximum, but we all agree that the maximum of the sine function is 1. So that's why we want to have a less than or equal to and a greater than or equal to when it comes to global maximum, because there's the idea that, oh, hey, something might be a maximum at multiple locations, and it's okay for us to do that. Now, that's why we have these signs for the global or absolute. Why do we have it for the local then? Aha! Why do we have it for the local is the following. We want the following statement to be true. And it's kind of a nice statement. So here's the statement. So if we are a global or slash absolute max, so in other words, if we are the largest possible that we can possibly be, then we are also a local max. So, lo and behold, if I have a local max, it's potentially a global max, but it doesn't have to be. But if I do have a global max, it definitely is a local max. It has to be larger than everything nearby. So I have to leave the inequalities in this way to make it compatible so that, lo and behold, if I do have a absolute slash global max, I also have a local max. So that's why the inequalities work the way they do. All right, well, good. So what do we do? Well, what are we after? We're trying to understand where the max and mins occur, and we want to connect it to our notion of differentiation. So the way we do it is to observe the following. When our derivative is positive, well, that says that our function looks locally like a line with positive slope. Now, it might be a shallow slope, so let's see, you know, it could be very steep, but it could be very shallow. It just depends. All right, so what do we have? So when our function has a derivative that's positive, then we are going uphill. So our function has to be something like this, where it's going uphill. It might not be going uphill very, very quickly, but it definitely goes uphill. When our derivative is negative, our function looks like a line with negative slope. So it looks like we're going downhill. Now, of course, when I say things like going uphill, going downhill, I mean that as we move from left to right, we go down when our derivative is negative, or we go up when our derivative is positive. Now, here's the idea. We say, look, that gives us some nice information. If it's the case that our derivative is not zero, and we have the freedom to move, then, lo and behold, I can move in one of the directions, left or right, and either go up or go down. And it doesn't matter whether my derivative is positive or negative. If my derivative is positive, then to go up, I move to the right. To go down, I move to the left. If my derivative is negative, to go up, I move to the left. To go down, I move to the right. But the point is, by a small change, I can move up or down the output. That means that locally, I'm not a max or min value. And that also means that globally, I'm not a max or min value. So I cannot be a max or min. Now, we added this condition, and that is that we have the freedom to move. Well, when may we not have the freedom to move? Well, one thing that can happen is the boundary. You see how it's here. C is not at the boundary. What we mean by that is by ruling out being at the boundary says, hey, I can move in either direction. So when I'm at the boundary, you can imagine that I have a function that, say, here is C, and I'm only defined from C to the right. Well, my function could do something like this. And you see that, you know, yeah, it does look like a nice flat line, more or less, but I can only move to the right of C. So I can only move up. I can't move to the left of C. That's not an available option to me. So that rules out being able to move down. All right. So now we have this great idea. It says, look, if my derivative is not zero and I have freedom of motion, I'm not at a maximum or minimum. Well, we want to look at maximums or minimums. So we say, okay, well, let's think about what needs to be true? Well, something had to break. So what are some things that could break? Well, we said if our derivative, you know, is not zero. So one thing that could happen is that our derivative could equal zero, or our derivative could be undefined. That's a way to rule out the derivative is not zero, if one of those two things are true. The other thing is the motion. We can't move freely in both directions. So that's the boundary. So we say, aha, we're going to call these the critical points. Now, from our perspective, the critical, these are really critical in the sense of important for behavior. Something interesting happens to the function, potentially at least, at these points. So they're critical for us to understand what the function is doing. And in particular, what the function is doing in regards to maximums and minimums. So we have the following simple observation. And that is, a local max or min can only occur at a critical point. So if I'm looking for maxes and mins, and we will be, the way we do it is we say, all right, let's start looking for critical points. All right, do we have a boundary? All right, throw those in. Do we have any places where the derivative is undefined or where the derivative is zero? Throw those in. So essentially what we've done is instead of saying, hey, you don't have to check every point that you can plug into your function, focus on just the handful that satisfy these potential locations, these critical points, and that will help us figure it out. All right, now, that's the notion of critical points, and you're going to hear us talking a lot about critical points, especially going forward as we start doing problems which involve finding maximum and minimums. There's another idea which is related, and it's called the extreme value theorem. Extreme in the case of maximum and minimum. So when we're talking about extreme value theorem, we're saying there's a theorem that says there is a max and a min. And here's the condition. If we have a continuous function, which is working on a closed and bounded interval. So closed means I include the endpoints. So that's why you have these equalities here. Bounded says I don't head off to infinity. So we have to be continuous, closed, and bounded. Then the function has an absolute max and an absolute min. In other words, it must, no matter what function you give me, as long as it satisfies it's continuous and has a closed bounded interval, there is no option. There will be an absolute max and an absolute min. It is unavoidable. Now, why are these things important? Well, why is it important to be continuous? Well, that's not so hard to convince ourselves. We can create functions which are certainly not continuous. So let's go from A up to B, and we'll start here at A, and we'll move up, and then we'll go here. Now, if you look at this function, it is a defined for everywhere between A and B. It's not continuous, though, because at looks like zero here, we have this discontinuity. It's a jump discontinuity. Now, is there a max or min? Well, you might be tempted to say, hey, look at this. Isn't this the max? And the answer to that question is no. Why not? Well, because I need to have a value of the function. So it has to be an output. There's no number you can plug in which produces this output. So you say, okay, well, maybe that's not the max. Maybe I just have to go a little bit below it. Well, now here's the problem. You see, a little bit below leaves you still some gap. And so you say, well, I can't go just right below because that's not how numbers work. And once I have a gap, well, I can find a value of the function which I can input, which gets me closer to my missing point. See, I can always get closer and closer to this point, but that particular point I can never attain. And so there is no absolute max. By the same token, this is not a min, because again, I can't not get to it. But neither is it an output of the function. So that's why continuity is important, because of the potentials for these kinds of situations where I can get closer and closer to something, but I can't actually achieve that output. Now, I should add a caveat here. I am not saying the following, that if I have a function which is not continuous, then it can't have an absolute max and absolute min. That's not true. Because, of course, you can create functions which are not continuous but still have an absolute max and an absolute min. So you can create a function that does something like this. And we'll just sort a little bit there. That's not a continuous function, but you can say, hey, here, this is a min, yes, and up here, roughly right here, there's the max at that point. That's not a circle, I should say. I'm just pointing to that point there. Okay? So it is possible that you're not continuous, but you still have an absolute max or min. We're not saying that's ruled out. What we are saying is the theorem here is if you are continuous and you have a nice closed bound interval, it must exist. And that's sort of that extra, the fact that it must exist, not that it might exist, that distinction to be made. Why is it important that our interval is nice and closed and bounded? Well, we can have something maybe along the lines of the following, where we have a function that does something like this. This looks somewhat like e to the minus x kind of has this shape to it, where I have the domain all the way off to infinity. The problem here is, what do you see? What's the min? Well, the problem is the min looks like zero, but I can't actually plug anything in which produces zero. On the other hand, I can always get closer and closer. So it's that same as like, I can get closer and closer, but I can't actually reach it. So that's the problem going on. So anyways, that's why we need those assumptions. Once you have those assumptions, then you know it's an absolute max and an absolute min. There has to be one somewhere. Possibly, it's, you know, you can have a function which attains an absolute max at several locations. Sine was an example. Now you might be wondering, can we prove this? And the answer is yes. It only takes about another 2 or 3 years of math study, and then you can prove it. And it's beautiful. It's a wonderful idea. It's not going to be in the scope of our class. So for right now, we're just going to take it on faith. So how do we use that? Well, the main use of the extreme value theorem is to say, I know there is a max or a min. I know it exists. And knowing its existence gives you huge power, because now you say, okay, given that I know it exists, I have a way to find it. So here's how we do it. So we do the following. First off, we say, where could it be? Well, we know where to look for max and some mins. We find the critical points. So we find the critical points. It's going to be a handful of points. We say, all right, wherever the max and min are, it has to be somewhere among these list of points. So the next thing is, well, let's look at what happens to the function when we plug those points into the function. So that's looking at the outputs. And now, the last thing is we say, okay, let's look at what outputs we got. Whatever the largest value is, that has to be the absolute max. Whatever the smallest value is, that has to be the absolute min. It's a simple process. And just think of the classic song, which goes something like this. We're making a list, checking it twice, going to find out which points are nice. Absolute max and min are found. Right? Because that's how the process goes. Make a list. You check it. Make sure you haven't missed anything. And then you plug in the values. And now you look at the outputs. So, make your list. Check it twice. You're going to find out which points are nice. And of course, that means some time for practice. Good. So go and do some practice now.